Hello everyone, just a quick word from your friendly editor slash husband. For all of you who listen to So I'm Watching This Show and own an Android device, do me a favor. Go to the Google Play Store and download the Podcast Republic app. It's a fantastic app that allows you to get all of your favorite podcasts directly on your Android devices. I use the app and love it. I can search for the podcasts I want to listen to, select them as favorites, and have them all just a click away. Make sure you set So I'm Watching the Show as a favorite so you don't miss any new episodes. Again, the app is Podcast Republic, available on your Android device. Thanks!
We're late for our flight! We gotta go!
What?
Because we're going to Europe on this trip!
Oh. We're not flying anywhere. Everything is canceled.
With the power of imagination, we're going to go on a trip to Europe. We can't even go to World Showcase at Epcot.
I know, it's awful.
Hello, everybody. I am Will.
And I'm Kristen.
And this is So I'm Watching This Show, your twice weekly pop culture podcast where we talk about movies, TV, music, and more. And as always, this is a spoiler show, so you have been warned. So on today's episode, we're going to have a discussion about two movies, one new, one old, but both share the theme of Europe.
Sort of.
Yeah. We're going to do Eurovision shit. What is the title of this movie?
Eurovision Song Contest, The Story of Fire Saga.
And we're going to lead with that one. We feel stronger about that one. And then we'll transition into the 2004 zany sex comedy Eurotrip to see if it holds up. And you'll have to wait to find
you'll
out
have to
the
wait
answer
to find
that.
Out what we think.
Did you have anything broad you wanted to say about Eurovision?
So before you told me I should watch it, I saw a handful of people talking about it, and I was like, this seems silly, and it seems like smack in the middle of the Will Ferrell I don't care for all mm-hmm. that much. And so I was just like, whatever, I'm not really into it. Rachel McAdams was the only thing that was drawing me in at all. Even though I know a very little bit about Eurovision in general, because I am on Tumblr.
I was going to say, we actually have a slight understanding of it because of Tumblr.
It's like every year I would see these
GIFs.
They're just sometimes full videos of just the most bonkers performances you could ever imagine. And so I finally understood what it was. But I was not wild about even trying out this movie at mm-hmm. first. And then you were like, no, it's actually really cute. You should watch it. And I did. And I was immediately smitten. So,
okay.
Yeah, that's my without talking about the plot. That's mm-hmm. what I've got.
I knew nothing about this movie. It dropped mysteriously out of nowhere. And I think it was intended as a theatrical release for the spring. I think it was maybe May or something that it was going to be.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, May 2020.
This would have been a bad theater release.
Yeah, yeah. Very, very bad. I am so glad it worked out the way that it did. And like you, I was familiar. My introduction actually came from my college roommate, Corey. She had a friend who was from England. Mm-hmm. And in 2006 and 2007... her family was sending her VHSs of Eurovision to watch.
That's hilarious.
And I remember Corey trying to explain it to me, and she was like, you would love it. And she kept saying it's like American Idol, but she was like, but more. She's like, it's so gay. It's so huge. I guess it's a song contest, which is a thing, which is a specific thing. It's not a talent contest the way that we think of The Voice or American Idol. So it's you are submitting a song and only the song. That's why sometimes it can be a band or even just a gimmick, you know, mm-hmm. there's a I can't think of her name, but there's a drag queen. She's in the Melissa McCarthy movie Spy.
Mm, OK,
that was a figure from Eurovision and stuff. But yeah, that you say so you submit a song and you go through and it's 50 countries vote on it. It is huge. It gets almost 200 million views.
That's
which
insane.
It's more than the Super Bowl. This is a bigger deal than the Super Bowl. And it's just wild that so few Americans have even heard of it. You know what I mean? It's like, it's so completely, it's such a huge thing. And we know nothing about it. But yeah, so this movie was released, and my brother loves Will Ferrell, and he loves silly comedies, and he loves rom-coms. And so we were at my parents' house, and we put it on, and I thought it was so stupid. I was like, this movie is so dumb. It was the gentlest comedy. It was like the suggestion of comedy for like so much of it. And I was even weirdly, like, at first I was put off by Dan Stevens. I was like, really? We're doing like gay jokes? Like, come on. And I just reached a point, and I had things to do that night. Like, I had work to do. And I reached a point where I was like, I am standing in front of the TV, and it's like an hour into this movie, and I cannot pull myself away from it. And so we watched the whole thing, and I was like, that was fine. And I wrote a little Twitter review, and I was like, it's too long, which, T, facts, true. It is too long.
It's like just over 2 hours.
Although I think half of that is because of the musical numbers.
That's probably true.
Because if you cut them, you'd lose 20 minutes of the movie. So
yeah, but why on earth would you cut
exactly,
the music?
Exactly.
There's no excuse.
And I do think all of the jokes are very, like I already said, gentle. It feels very much like a draft that needed to go through two or three more rounds and get punched up. Like, I think a lot of the bits.
Yeah, it could have been punched up, but I also, if something about it feels very European in that way. It does feel sort of gentler than the comedy that we are in America right now.
Yes. And we are honestly going that direction. We're heading that direction. But I did find out that I did a little bit of research, and it was made in cooperation with Eurovision.
Oh, okay.
So that, to me, explains why they really didn't go hard, like, in on Eurovision itself.
Yeah. Well, also, I mean, that's such a bad look to make a movie specifically to dump all over something that is just like a good, all in good fun song competition.
But yeah, so that stage, the huge stage at the end, is it's the stage in Tel Aviv where they've hosted several times and stuff. Mm-hmm. So it's like, that's how, because remember we were watching it, and I was like, this set is huge.
Yeah.
And it's like, so they were using, you know, Eurovision's actual equipment and stuff.
Okay, cool. Even though it was supposed to be in Edinburgh.
Yes. Because there's even a weird plot hole there, because they make a comment about how like the UK never wins.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, they're hosting this year. So, so when I was done, I was like, you know what? It's too long, and it needs to be funnier. But there was this weird sweetness that reared its head through the movie. And it shockingly, it reminded me of the silly Hallmark and Lifetime Christmas movies, where it's like, it was so formulaic and so by the books, but it was so pleasant, it was so amusing along the way, that I didn't really mind that I wasn't being challenged, you know?
Yeah.
So I kind of wanted to watch it again. It was one of those things where, remember when you were a kid and you would watch a movie and all you knew is that you just wanted to watch it again? You didn't really know why. You couldn't pinpoint what exactly about it, but you just wanted to spend more time with it.
Oh yeah.
That's what it did to me. And so we watched it again the next night, because my brother fell asleep the first night. So we watched it again the next night, and my mom watched it too. And they were like, yeah, that was cute. Like, we liked that too. And I liked it even better the next night. And so I proceeded to listen to the soundtrack and stuff. And we talked about it a little bit, a couple weeks passed. And basically at this point, I think I've probably seen it 7 times. Like,
yeah, I've seen it a lot too.
Like, I suspected it's gone into my brother's like rotation. And so he'll just put it on like when he's not doing anything. And like, I told you, he came home the other day, and like when he came in the door, he was like, I see you. And he was like, there you are.
I don't know. Like, so much about it is so catchy. I've had Ya Ya Ding Dong stuck in my head for like 2 straight weeks now.
Well, because the thing was, is you're a very game audience member. Like, you're very like, cool, awesome, give me your thing, I can't wait to love it.
Sure.
And you go you go with things very frequently. You're not fighting the premise.
I try really hard not to, because I feel like those people are no fun at parties, and I like to be fun at parties.
And so when it was over, you immediately were trying to play it for Will, and he was barely interested.
No.
And this isn't really his type of thing, and certainly not at this point in his life, but you were like trying to play Ya Ya Ding Dong for him, and you were just waiting for him to be in hysterics.
It is the funniest song in the world. It's so inappropriate. It's so overtly sexual. It is so ridiculous. I don't know why anybody wouldn't find it hilarious.
Well, it's a slight play on especially songs from like the 50s and 60s that at the time, like, you don't think, like, I don't know, yummy, yummy, yummy,
yeah,
I've
sure.
got love in my tummy. And yeah. it's just kind of like, there's all these songs that when you get like older, you're like, ooh, there's weird connotations to
like
a
Afternoon
lot of these.
Delight.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, yeah, you once you're, you know, semi grown up, you're like, all of these songs are about sex.
I
like,
want to spill my love
sex.
On you. Yeah.
Yeah, it's hilarious. My love for you is growing long and wide. That's hilarious. I don't know what to tell you if you don't think that's funny. And especially like listening to obviously Rachel McAdams' voice double, but listening to her sing it so earnestly, like it's a real song.
Because that's the thing, and I think that, like, going and playing it for Will just, like, immediately after the movie is it robs it of the context of the movie.
Fair
and
enough.
What makes it so funny is that everyone in this village is, like feverishly obsessed yeah. with this song and this song alone.
I get it.
And it's the... it's the one guy, I can't remember his name. Yeah, they're all...
Oh, yeah, what is his name?
Names, there's no way that... It's not Arnar. I know Arnar, but regardless, he's just like frenzied and he's just like play Ya Ding Dong and he's yeah. just like screaming. And at one point he was like, I want nothing else in the world, only Ya Ya Ding Dong.
Get back in there right now and play Ya Ya Ding Dong.
No, we are done for tonight.
You have to play it.
Why do I have to play it? I already played it.
I don't care. You have to play it again.
Tell me, when will it be enough for you?
It will never be enough. I only want to hear Ya Ya Ding Dong.
It's too funny.
It's almost British. Like, there's almost like a weird, the humor. It and like I said, it's for me, it was a kind where it's like, it's funnier on the fifth watch than it is on the first watch.
Mm-hmm.
Like when Will Ferrell is doing the, I can only take so much shit. And he's like, I can take this much shit, but not this much shit.
Yeah.
And she's so earnestly trying. She's like, I know, I understand. There's a weird, like you said, sweetness and like an earnestness and like an innocence to so much of it.
Yeah.
That it just like, it reminded me of what it felt like to believe in things.
Yeah, yeah, I agree with that. I weirdly, even though it's exactly the joke that you see coming a mile away, I love, love the moment when Lars tells Sigrid, he's like, my dad is selling the house and I don't have any place to live. And it's because he's disappointed in me and I don't make him proud. And she's like, I'm sure that's not. No, he looked me in the eyes and said, you don't make me proud. And then he just keeps going. She's like, maybe he was drunk. And he said, no, he was. He said, and you might think I'm drunk, but I'm sober and I'm not proud. And it just like keeps going like three different ways over. And I don't know if it's just because I am simple and find that kind of stuff funny or if it's his delivery or if it's just imagining Pierce Brosnan saying those things to Will Ferrell.
It's all of them.
It's so funny.
Because both Lars and Sigrid are kind of, I don't know how to say this. I don't want it to sound bad. I don't mean it bad, but they're both kind of simple. Like they're very straightforward. And so there's just something about watching people without irony or without like
art, there's no artifice to them.
Yeah. Like there's no, like they're not jaded. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because, like, the scene towards the end where Will Ferrell is back on the fishing boat and he's talking to, like, the 13-year-old drummer. And he's like, give up on your dreams now before it's too late.
Yeah.
Like, it's like that just dawned on him that, like, at, like, 40-something years, Lars has only figured out that maybe sometimes dreams don't come true.
Right,
like,
exactly.
I think another thing about it that's really interesting is its identity as, the Icelandness of it all.
Yeah.
I watched a reaction video with a Icelandic girl, the most beautiful girl I have ever seen in my entire life. I'm not even afraid I'm overselling it. Her name was Hrafna, H-R-A-F-N-A.
Mm-hmm.
And she kind of watched the whole movie, and it was like those kind of cut together clips where she was just commenting as it was playing.
Mm-hmm.
And she mostly liked it. She actually very much liked it. And she said it's very popular in Iceland. Like, it was like number one. And she said it was very stereotypical, that most of the stuff isn't so much authentically Icelandic as it at, like, she was like, they're all wearing the sweaters.
Oh, and it's just like a feeling of Iceland.
Yeah, a suggestion. And she was like, the handful of times where they're speaking Icelandic, she was like, they're trying their best and we appreciate it. Mm. But she was like, it's not even close.
No.
And especially because they're like, so many of the other actors are proper Icelandic actors and stuff.
Sure. Well, Pierce Brosnan is so Irish, he can only do so much.
And the biggest thing for her that she was the most put off by is, like, literally every name was Swedish and not Icelandic.
I was just thinking of that, actually, because, like, these aren't totally right.
Yeah, like, Lars is and because she even was trying to translate, she was like, we wouldn't even say it that way in Iceland. Mm. And I think it's just because Americans, like, we have a better grasp on, like, we're more familiar with Swedish than we are.
Well, sure. It's just all sort of, like, vaguely Scandinavian.
Yeah. But, like, Husavik is a real place, and a handful of, like, the bits and stuff is real. And she enjoyed it. I think she felt a little bit patronized.
Mm-hmm.
But for the most part, she said that they were all getting a kick out of being the focus of a big pop culture.
I mean, it's sort of like when movies take place in Orlando.
Mm-hmm.
And we're like, oh my god, it's the SunTrust building.
I love that Sigrid is kind of like a low-key drunk.
Yeah. She's Icelandic. Yeah. Well, she does it with the coffee at the beginning, too. Because Lars is like, ooh, coffee.
Off?
Well, yeah. Through the whole movie. Because she walks up to him and she goes, he's like, two coffees, and she goes, both for me.
Well, yeah,
and she keeps them both. And then throughout the movie, every time someone gives, like, she takes the two drinks from Lemtov and she goes, oh, two for me. She does it multiple times. It's funny.
No, I mean, I know that part, but I was like, was there an explanation, I guess? And I guess there's not. It's just a character trait.
Yeah, I thought it was just like a funny thing about her.
I also low-key love every jacket Will Ferrell wore in this movie.
Yeah, I unironically like a ton of the things that Rachel McAdams wears.
Mm.
Like, especially her disco ball dress at the party.
She's so funny as this character and with this accent.
Mm-hmm.
Because I love when she gets so mad. It's the scene in the middle where they're threatening to go sex nuts.
Yeah.
And because that's something that the Icelandic girl commented on, when she's like, I know rotten shark meat when I smell it. And the Icelandic girl is like, okay, so fine, rotten shark meat is an actual thing that we eat here.
She was
like, but that's not something people say. I think it's like one of those weird delicacies, but
sure.
But so it was like, there was things like peppered through it that she's like, I mean, that's a thing, but not quite that way.
Sure.
It very much has like a Pitch Perfect straight to DVD vibe to it.
Sure.
Because there is the kind of Pitch Perfect knockoff where they all sing the montage of songs.
Mm-hmm. It's called a song along on this.
And it was good songs, too. You were really into the fact that it was Believe by Cher and then Ray of Light.
Yeah, those are excellent songs. I have no complaints.
Those are all real Eurovision cameos. I only knew Conchita. I knew Conchita again from Tumblr, but you can kind of infer watching it. You're like, these are people I can tell.
Sure. Yeah.
And, you know, honestly, I think my favorite part of the movie is Alexander and Mita.
I do like them a lot. Yes.
Especially because they are introduced to us as like stereotypical mustache twirling villains.
Mm-hmm.
And they're really not.
Yeah.
I mean, they're definitely trying to derail Fire Saga, but both of them end up actually liking each of their quests, you know?
Well, yeah, and they it's, like as people. It's and it seems like they are friendly already, but they seem to come out the other side with a stronger friendship with one another as well.
Yeah, and it's like that was the thing, and especially because, like I said, at first when the whole his whole lion of love.
Mm-hmm. I am not joking at all. All of the songs are hilarious and amazing.
Chilling with the homies.
I will not apologize.
But yeah, when we introduced to him, I was like, oh God, I was like, we're really going to do, like, it felt really, at first I assumed it was going to be like a really outdated, like 2004 gay joke. Mm. And it starts there, but it doesn't end there. And
right.
He's never humiliated. He's never like, well, and again, even her, it's like when she tries to seduce Will Ferrell, actually, it happens very quickly where she's just like, I actually just like you. She's like, mm-hmm. I'm kind of not going to do this. And there's the scene at the end where when Sigrid realizes that Alexander's gay and he has that hilarious but also deeply pathetically heartbreaking
yeah.
little monologue with the where he's like not gay and yeah. he does the like he him pronoun.
Yeah. It's also like, it's like heartbreaking, and it's also just, I think it's one of the only moments where the movie goes to a real dark place that mm-hmm. the rest of the movie cannot really sustain, because that is a real problem in Russia.
He's not, I mean, he does deny being gay, but also he just keeps saying there are no gay people in Russia.
Right.
And so it's like he doesn't have the option. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? And of course, the heroes win, and it ends with Mita coming over, and she's just like, you know, you don't have to do this. And she's like, let me take you to Greece, mm-hmm. which is just so hilarious. Like it. And he's just like, I do love the statues.
The statues.
It was so warm and sweet and not hateful in a way that I've been conditioned to expect from these yeah. kinds of movies.
Definitely.
That it really, it, yeah. We didn't mention Demi Lovato. She's in like maybe 2 minutes of this movie. I really.
That's not a lot.
I really think they could have, she could have had a proper scene.
I agree. I mean, she sang awesomely.
Yeah, I don't know what part it would be, but I definitely think she should have had a proper scene. And she does have a funny running bit that only it only goes twice with the ghost. But I also do want to mention Husivik, the song.
The song? Oh, my God.
Is it your favorite?
It's my favorite. It's so good. I mean, I do love their like actual entry song.
Double Trouble.
Double Trouble is really good too. So, it sounds like an ABBA song.
It grows so mm-hmm. big. It grows so big and wide, or yeah. big and long.
No, but yeah, Husovic is, I think, definitely the best song. I mean, it's set up to be that way, but I think it's the best song of the movie.
Well, it's like, it's a ballad, and though those usually end up being crowd pleasers, at least for me, I tend to kind of be like, ugh, really? Mm. And it really does nail it. And I think it's sort of indicative of the entire movie as a whole, where it's just this strange, sweet exercise in self-expression.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I love the lyrics. Like, seriously, the she talks about like the seagulls cry over the mountains or something mm-hmm. and where the whales can live because they're gentle people.
I
and
know.
There's something about that lyric that like it touches you like at your core. You're like, they are though. Like
yeah.
it's so true. And her voice double is Molly Sandon, although she's credited as My Marianne. I'm not totally sure why. She must have, like, she must be a person. And I actually did find out that Rachel did sing. It's a combination of their voices. So I think probably the more proper singing is Molly.
Sure.
I had had it in my mind at a certain point that traditional Icelandic music didn't really have lyrics.
Oh.
It's more just vocal. Like, it's just more sounds. Because that's how Jónsi and Sigur Rós does a lot of their, like, some of their songs have lyrics, obviously, but some of them, it's just sort of, like, I don't want to say gibberish, but yeah, noises.
Sounds, yeah.
And so when they weren't translating the Icelandic, because they translated the rest of it, I thought maybe that's what she was doing. But then I was able to find, although everybody was debating what she actually says, but I was able to find some translations.
Okay.
But so if that is true, then look how smart I am. And if it's not... I'm pretty creative. So either way, I win.
Either way, you win. Good job.
But yeah, that was, I had it in my head at some point that it was a thing unique to Icelandic culture, is that they had a specific style of singing wasn't necessarily.
I thought what you were going to say is that it was sort of like Moana, where it's really hard to get the, like, Pacific Islander language to match up with what the English actually means. So that it was like a real feat that she was able to do that. That's what I thought it was going to be.
No, because I think what she's saying is it's like Husavik by the bay is, I think, what it says. And there's something about, like, the earth moving, because there were earthquakes at one point. Okay. Iceland, I want to go to Iceland so bad. It looks beautiful. It seems like a real experience, but it also kind of seems hellish. Like,
I just, like,
it really feels like the edge of the earth.
I get really worried that I'm just gonna be hearing, like, Bjork all the time. Like, just in the air. Like, that's just what Iceland sounds like, is what I'm worried about.
I feel like it's primordial, like the earth hasn't fully finished setting. You know,
it's not done, like, in Iceland.
No, I actually in my research I found some videos about, like, their lifestyle and how they are also one of the happier. It's like that word, I forget what it is, but how Scandinavian countries are very happy, very content. And one of the things that seemed delightful is, I guess there are publicly funded or publicly run. They have baths. They're like natural hot springs.
Oh, sure.
And so
subsidized.
Yeah. So people, it's like Americans and swimming pools in the summer. It's like people go down to the hot baths in the winter and stuff. And they showed pictures of it. And it was like this aqua milky looking, just open pools, like organic natural pools. And people were hanging out in them, like dozens of people. And I was like, I want to do that.
Yeah, that seems like fun. Not right now.
No. No. I feel like there was a couple other things that I wanted to say, but it's the kind of thing that's like we juggled talking about this back and forth a few times.
Yeah.
So it's like I'm on my third interpretation of the movie. But
I feel like we can't pass up the opportunity to just at least mention the elves. I don't think we have to take that conversation to its conclusion, but there is a hilarious runner in this movie with elves, and it does have a satisfying conclusion. So.
And it's another one of the ones that, at least for me, I could see coming from a mile away, but it still was nonetheless satisfying, because John McNamara from The Magicians, writer, creator of The Magicians, he commented that it has one of the better elf related plot twists. And he was like, and I've written a few myself. I've
got a couple of those down. Yeah. And then I also we were talking about, like, the earnestness of it. And I also can't pass up an opportunity to talk about how good Rachel McAdams is at acting, because for me, it is the scene when Lars leaves her after the, like, hamster wheel situation, when they are actually competing, and she, like, goes into the artist's room and sits by herself, and she is filthy, and she has, like, a Lydia Martin mark across her neck where the scarf choked her, and her hair is a disaster, and she sits there with her head held high even though she's kind of crying. It was like, I was very moved by that moment of the movie.
I actually did want to mention, though, and this is weirdly more for Will, but since I know he's going to edit it, it's like, I'll tell you now. I watched a couple of videos of, like, Eurovision fans reacting to it, and they said what he said, because I could tell the movie kind of lost him a little bit towards the end when mm-hmm. everyone was like booing them and stuff. And
yeah,
all of the fans were like, if anything, we'd be more inclined to vote for them for finishing the number that went so wrong, because he was like, that wasn't their fault. Like that was all movie stuff. And the way that Eurovision works, he was like, no, if that happened on Eurovision, he was like, they would be a sensation. Like everybody would love them. And apparently so much of that stuff is real. The hamster wheel is something someone did a few years ago.
Mm-hmm.
They're like the Mita's whole number with like the space suit. It's like so much of it is almost just like, it's not even a parody. It's just a depiction. Like
it's just happening. Well, that was one of the things I liked the best when I was hearing stuff about it was, I think it was either Glenn Weldon or Linda Holmes. And they just were like, so it's not like mean enough to be an actual joke. So it's just ends up being like a faithful adaptation of Eurovision. It's like, I mean, that sounds kind of fun.
Cause I also like the running bit with the Americans. And if anything, I kind of wish that he went harder on the Americans.
A little. Yeah.
Cause it is funny. Cause like up until that point, we have like no real reason to believe Lars has a mean bone in his body.
Right. And then they interrupt his talking to his reflection. And he just goes nuts.
Give me a break, man. Can't you see I was talking to my reflection?
Chill out, bro.
You chill out, bro. Why do you Americans always say chill out like that to everyone?
Jeff, let's go. The guy's nuts.
Wait, I'm nuts? Hey, Europe is not your party town. All right? You come over here and you shit on everything.
Oh. Come on.
Show some freaking respect.
Oh,
all right?
God.
Go home and build your wall. You shit for brands, Americans.
Get out of here.
Lars. They love Starbucks. Hey, go to Starbucks. They have a special for Americans.
Where's the Starbucks?
That Starbucks, it's anywhere you look, okay?
Oh.
Just smell for the pumpkin spice latte.
Okay, thank you.
I'm not saying thank you back.
Was he trying to help?
I think so.
It's
we deserve it. It's real.
And I also do kind of love how the Americans are just like, okay, cool. Like, bye.
Because he's trying to be mean and he's like, go find a Starbucks. And they're like, oh, where's the Starbucks? And he goes, everywhere. Starbucks is everywhere. Just follow the smell of pumpkin spice latte. And she's like, okay, thanks.
Yeah, it's going to be one of my faves for the year.
Yeah,
definitely. So from there, we don't have to talk a lot about this, but we watched the 2004 sex comedy Eurotrip.
Scotty doesn't know that Fiona and me do it in my van every Sunday. She tells him she's in church, but she doesn't go. Still, she's on her knees, and Scotty doesn't know.
First time for me in easily 10 years, if not more.
Yeah, same.
You saw it when it came out, right?
No, you made me watch it one time.
I made you watch it? Okay. It's a special, special movie for me. I was 18 and 7 months when this came out, so I couldn't have been more the demographic.
The exact right age.
We saw it in the theater, and it was like a group of like 12 of us. And for some reason, I remember Ryan Stockman really, really laughing because he had had like dental surgery that day and he was still a little high.
Yeah.
And so I had that memory. But then also we went back to senior week because this was the year after we graduated, and we stayed at our buddy Sharif's house and he didn't have cable. So we had like a handful of DVDs and this was one of them. So we just watched it like 5 times that week.
Yeah.
And so that's what it means to me. And it's like when we put it on and when the credits start rolling and there's all like the sex jokes in the like airplane manual, it like even now would get me excited, almost kind of like butterflies in my stomach, because I'm like, oh, yeah, here we go. It's like an adult movie, a sex movie. And it still gave me that feeling the second time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was terrified to sit down and watch it. I was afraid it was not going to age well. I was more afraid that it just wasn't going to be funny. Like, I was afraid that I was going to be disappointed in myself for finding it funny when I was younger.
Mm.
And I can proudly and safely say that was not the case.
No, I was laughing probably too much.
More than we should admit. It is very, very of its time. And it's a very specific time. And it's so funny. I would be so curious for a young person today to watch it and tell me what they think, like an 18-year-old, mm-hmm. to see if any of it translates. Because it was this very specific, it's 2004, the pop punk is everywhere. And it's like,
yeah,
it's similar with it's similar with a movie like Mean Girls, where it's like, it's modern enough that it doesn't feel like an old movie. Mm-hmm. But also it's like, there's not really cell phones. Like, there's only the one cell phone in the movie.
That's what I was going to say, is like, Mean Girls is actually like, I think it holds up better than this so well until you realize that they're like three-way calling each other on landlines. And then you're like, mm-hmm. oh God, what mm-hmm. is happening?
There's just a handful of bits in this one that are like, we're like watching the VHS, mm-hmm. like the stuff rewinding on the VHS and all that. And there's just a handful of things. But I think that as far as taste, like accounting for taste, it's pretty sexist in the way that all of these are. I saw a review. Elvis Mitchell of the New York Times wrote that any girl in the movie with fewer than 10 lines to speak has to take her top off.
I was going to say, because we talked about it in another recent thing, which is that Mika is absolutely a sexy lamp. There's nothing to her at all, except for that she's very, very pretty and her boobs are incredible. Mm-hmm. That's like pretty much it.
I do think the movie knows that. I think she is playing that role.
Of course.
It's not that it thinks that's what femaleness is.
Well, and I also will argue about it being a better depiction than something like American Pie, in which Shannon Elizabeth is somehow has more screen time and lines, but is more objectified.
American Pie, I have not rewatched it since I was like 14 or whatever, but that's one that I've had a hard time with making my peace with, because that scene with Shannon Elizabeth, we've mentioned a few times, but basically she's a foreign exchange student that they spy on. So they're voyeuristically like
peeping Toms.
Yeah. They're already violating her privacy. And then on top of that, they're broadcasting it for everyone to watch.
Yeah.
And when she finds out, she's happy about it.
Right.
And it just really, really sets a horrible, dangerous, toxic standard for the teenagers watching it.
For sure.
And this movie, I think, avoids really falling down that hole. You know, I mean, there's the scene in the hot tub with
Cooper.
Yeah, where he's trying to get the girl to play with her boobs or whatever. And it doesn't feel nearly as predatory as.
No, I mean, it's definitely not great, but he's also not doing anything to her.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
it's like, it's, I think, dicey, but I think it's certainly not as bad as as most of the things in American Pie.
Yeah. And I think the inclusion of Jenny, I think having Michelle Trachtenberg, having mm-hmm. a female perspective and also a reliable, like a very grounded female perspective.
Yeah.
Does the movie some favors?
I had forgotten, and I do love the running bit where they just are like, all the time, the three of them are like, chicks, am I right? And she's like, I'm a girl. I am one. I'm a girl who went to your school. And it's just, I really do like that, because I've always had girlfriends, but I have hung out with groups of dudes a lot in my life. And that is accurate. Where they just are like, man, talk about broads, right? And I'm like, right here. Mm-hmm. I'm in front of you.
There are a handful of the requisite homophobic jokes. However, they're also more on the gentler side than you would get.
Like, well, they don't necessarily feel, to me, they don't feel like gay panic jokes. It's just like the Fred Armisen shit is like, that's that a creepy
weird.
Dude.
Yeah, it's that he's weird, not that he's a man is right. the implication. And it's like, because there's even the scene where Cooper thinks that Scotty's coming out, and he mm-hmm. handles it really well. There's no gay panic, like
shockingly well for a movie in 2004.
And for these boys being yeah. depicted. Mm-hmm. And it ends up being far more good natured than I think some of its contemporaries.
I agree.
And I mean, there's plenty of crude sex comedy, but it's mostly just like, outdated terms or ideals. Because it's like, I remember the, I feel so weird saying the R word, but I also don't feel like I need to say it. So the R word. We used to say that willy-nilly. Like, it was part of my lexicon in ways that when I think, because I don't quite remember, I can remember the Glee episode where they were like, stop doing it. Mm-hmm. And I remember thinking that was stupid. Like, I remember being like, really, Glee, that's so stupid. But also, I kind of remember somewhere deep inside me, I was like, well, never say that again.
Yeah. Well, it was because the girl with Down syndrome, right? The cheerleader on the show. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm.
It is wild.
It really is wild. The things we just used to say.
Yeah. And it appears like we just kind of stopped. That's the other interesting thing, because I've talked about it a bit with like Trey Parker and Matt Stone and Sarah Silverman with saying that's gay, where it's like they fought really hard for the right to say it and they made their case pretty eloquently. I kind of was even on their side. But also it's like once they made their case, they also just stopped.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It was just kind of like, cool. Well, now I don't need to do this anymore.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with that, because there are, it's something that I feel so many people don't realize because it doesn't apply to them or anyone they know. And so it's like, if you're just saying those things, you're like, well, I don't mean it that way. And it's like, it doesn't matter if you mean it that way, someone's going to take it that way. And it's not a nice thing to say pejoratively, so don't.
Well, it's the kind of thing that's like, for instance, like saying that's gay to mean like that's lame or that's stupid or whatever. I was fine with it in the 2000s, you know what I mean? And I would reach points where I would have friends where they would say it or they would hesitate and they'd be like, oh, do you mind if I say that? Like, is that going to bother you or whatever? And I felt kind of twofold about it. I felt number one, I was like, no, it doesn't really bother me all that much. But the fact that you know to ask me that means you know it is offensive.
Yeah, it means you know you shouldn't say it. So why are you saying it?
I was like, so you're kind of already losing, because the whole point that, you know, Matt and Trey and Sarah were making is that like it means something different because words evolve, which is true. You know, that's fine. You know, like I said, they made a case and I was like, you know, sure, whatever. I'm fine with that. And for me, I also put a lot of stock into, you know, as we say a lot, context and intent. It's like I can tell when someone is intending to be hurtful.
Right.
I mean, language is language. It is a means to an end. It is a way to express ourselves. And sometimes we go for the most efficient use of language and not the most proper. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I agree.
So I think with some of that context stuff, this movie is actually still pretty good. It holds up. Something that I like about the movie is that it also, like Eurovision Song Contest, the Story of Fire Saga, it's kind of positive. It's very kind of like
sweet. It has a sweetness.
It's kind of sweet. And it has a silliness and it has a whimsy that you frequently don't find in, like, this is a whimsical movie. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, no, it definitely is like a lot of, it's definitely one of those kind of wish fulfillment movies, because everything, even when something goes wrong, it kind of lines up perfectly for them. Like when they wind up in Bratislava by accident, it actually ends up being amazing. And it's like that kind of thing where, you know, everything goes a little too right. Like if that had happened to an actual group of people, they would still be in Bratislava.
Yes. But it's very lighthearted. Cause I mean, even the scene when Scotty chooses to have the like robot battle, like there's no real reason for that other than it's silly and kind of amusing for the audience to watch. And
yeah.
And there's a lot of really just like happy-go-lucky slap-kicky bits, because even in the robot battle, it's when the two of them are like charging each other in slow motion and you just see the little girl holding the balloon walk at normal speed in front of them. It harkens back, I think, to a simple, I don't know if simple is the word, but a more lighthearted time. And the cameos are actually pretty spot on. You know, Lucy Lawless. I can't even remember her name. It's Club Vondersex, though, which I want that t-shirt so bad. It just says Vondersex like seven times
in like
times
a bunch
a
of colors.
Kristen Kirk, Fred Armisen, Diedrich Baker.
I forgot about Diedrich Bader as like the like guy that mugs the one of the twins. I like straight up forgot about him. And it's while his name's Jamie, it's while he's getting a blowjob from the camera store lady, and he just is like, "Oh, I love you." And Dietrich Bader is like, "What?" It's hysterical. It's really, really funny.
And there's also, if you watch the stay through the credits, because there's some deleted scenes in the credits, and one of my favorite is Jennifer Saunders. Mm. And she's like a
she owns a hostel.
Uh-huh. And she has this whole monologue. I'll see if I can pull it. But it's the way she's pronouncing everything. Uh-huh. And she's talking about the rules of the hostel. And she's like,
"Hello and welcome to Amsterdam's finest and most luxurious youth hostel. We feature one medium-sized room containing 70 beds, which can sleep up to 375 bodies a night. There is no bathroom, nor is there one nearby. If you do not wish to have your valuables stolen, I suggest destroying them or discarding them right now. You can also try hiding your valuables in your anus. This will deter some, but of course, not all thieves. Once you're inside, the doors are chained and locked from the outside. They will not be opened again until the morning, no matter what. Should a fire occur due to a faulty wiring or the fireworks factory upstairs, you will be incinerated along with the valuables that you have hidden in your anus. Tips are greatly appreciated."
It kind of plays like a 30 Rock skit extended.
It does a little, yeah.
And Will pointed it out. I don't think I would have noticed if he didn't point it out, mm-hmm. but the movie does fall to absolute pieces in the third act.
Okay, it's a lot more like that, the thing that Mandy Moore does in American Dreams, because she literally is like, my trajectory is going to go like this. And she like shoots her hand up in the air and she's like, or it might be like this. And she shoots her hand up in the air and then she like makes an explosion sound and pops, goes back down to the bottom. That's what it feels like to me, is that it gets so, so huge and outsized and ridiculous. And then it kind of collapses. But for a while there, it's really zooming to the heavens. It's like trying so hard. And then it's just like, poof.
A roundabout child Hitler is where you should bow out of the movie.
Yeah, but that's tough, because there's also then footage in the deleted scenes over the credits of like the director
teaching him
how to walk like that. And I was like, this is not good.
It didn't feel so bad. It didn't feel so hurtful.
In
15 years ago,
it really didn't feel so bad. No, it didn't.
I also somehow forgot to mention Vinnie Jones as the English football hooligan.
Oh, man.
This is also like as authentically European as World Showcase. I mean, it is exactly the kind of like,
it's very like, yeah, they're just like, Manchester United is the only football team and we're drinking a lot of beer. And then they drive a red double decker bus from England to France.
You laughed so hard when Scotty started singing, "My baby takes the morning train."
And it's hilarious.
His name is Scott Malkowitz. Is that?
I think so.
Okay. I don't know who he is. He's only been in a handful of things, but he is so cute in this movie. And he is so funny. I wish he did more. Like, I really wish he kept on acting and stuff.
Because that was the thing I wanted to say when you were talking about the robot scene, is like, what this movie did for me is remind me the type of boys I liked when I was 17.
Oh my God.
And like, it's this type of boy.
Uh-huh.
Either one of them, Scott or Cooper, to be honest, either one of them.
Yeah. Because he looked like our friend Jake, who
he
was
does.
At the senior week with us.
Uh-huh. Well, and I so wasn't we there, would, but you were.
Well, not, yeah, with, yeah. And we remarked on it as we were watching it again and again and again. And also, I mean, we were talking about all the boobs. This is the rare smorgasbord of penis.
So many penises. I like can't even tell you. And it's all like
pull the Alexis Bledel from Sin City, all shapes, all sizes.
All sizes. It is mostly like unattractive, like men penises, but it is, I think, there.
It's
so
a variety.
There's a variety. So what are there, like, three sets of boobs in this movie then?
Oh, I mean, there's plenty because the Club Vondersex and...
Yeah, okay, so there's a bunch of boobs there. But there are far more penises in this movie than breasts. And I appreciate that, especially in the year 2004.
We haven't mentioned Scotty doesn't know.
Yeah, I was gonna, you said you were building to it, and I was like, I know that you're trying to do a bit right now, but like, we have to talk about it.
I didn't realize it was so universal, because we love, I bought the soundtrack, and the soundtrack is like pretty rockin', because it's like all of these like pop punk and also classic songs, but they're European covers.
Yeah.
They're like in other language, like My Generation is in another language.
Mm-hmm.
And there is the song Scotty Doesn't Know. And it's a shame for a movie to peak in the first 10 minutes.
That is true. That is true.
It is so funny. I would be so curious for a young person today to watch this movie and tell me if it's A, funny, if it B, translates at all, but C, does that still work? Because Scotty Doesn't Know is the height of comedy and also music. Like, it's such a banger.
It is such a banger.
It is such a banger. And it's just like,
I can't believe how much of a banger it still is. It rivals Ya Ya Ding Dong is all I'm saying.
I just like, I thought it was unique to us because of that one senior week. But then I have seen it on so many things. And it also, this movie weirdly has like a cult gay following. And I think it's because of the penises and the sensibility. I think because it is lighter hearted than so many of these movies, and the homophobia is much lighter. And then also, I mean, not to mention Michelle Trachtenberg, Lucy Lawless, like Jennifer Saunders, like there's people in this movie that really lend themselves to a gay following. But I have seen Scotty Doesn't Know on the list of gay songs. It's like songs that make gay people scream. And it was on that one graph where it was like a bop, a banger, and a jam.
And it was like smack in the middle.
It was like smack in the middle. Like, it's this band Lustra. I don't know what else they've done, but because I don't think he's even singing too, but the lead singer in the movie is Matt Damon. And we sat there the first time in the theater and watched that whole thing. And I think finally, like, one of us, like Tara, was like, is that Matt Damon?
Is that like, Matt Damon?
We were just kind of like, no. surely not. But the whole premise, in case you don't know and are listening this far, but the whole premise is that Scotty doesn't know that Fiona and the band member do it Matt in his Damon. Van every Sunday. She tells him she's in church, but she doesn't go. Still, she's on her knees.
Every
and
Sunday.
Scotty doesn't know.
Or and Scotty doesn't know, yeah.
And, yeah, no, it's that he doesn't know that his girlfriend, played by Kristen Kirk, is sleeping around, cheating on him. And everybody but him knows. And it's this huge scene at a party. And then the song takes off. And then it's like all through Europe. And there's like a techno remix version and stuff. And yeah, it's just.
It is also, though, nice because Scotty's really, really sad at first. And then the more times they hear it, he like actually gets into it. So it's nice that he has a sense of humor about it. And he's not like a dick about it.
And everybody gets a happy ending, and Scotty becomes Pope.
I mean, technically. I do have a couple of things, because I was just glancing at the trivia right now. Apparently, on the beach scene, when Michelle Trachtenberg the first scene she did it, and she shook out her hair so hard, she got dizzy and fell over.
No.
Which I just find hysterical. And then apparently at the graduation party, all the kegs were filled with real beer. So when Cooper gets thrown away from the hot tub incident, he's just actually drunk.
Oh.
And the last one is about Matt Damon, which is that he did the cameo because he was friends with Alec Berg, Jeff Schaefer, and Dave Mandel. And he was already in Prague shooting the Brothers Grimm. And he was wearing
at
a
least
wig.
Something good came out of that.
Yeah. And he was wearing a wig for that movie. So he just decided on a whim to shave his head for this cameo.
That's hilarious.
It wasn't written. He just did it. And it's so much more effective than he. Because if he was like clean cut looking Matt Damon, you would be like, oh, no, I get it. But the shaved head Matt Damon, you're like, it's just so much more effective.
Mm-hmm.
I just love it.
I kind of just really want to go watch it again right now. It's still good. We decreed it's still good.
It's good. I think if you can accept the 2004-ness of it and the, like, you know, half pleated skirts that Kristen Crook is wearing at the beginning, I think you'll be fine. And God love Michelle Trachtenberg. I really do. We are both Justice for Dawn on Buffy people, but her hair makes her look like a Cocker Spaniel in this movie. To a ridiculous degree.
Now put your clothes back on, white boy. Oh man, good times. So okay, I would say that's sufficient.
Awesome. Well, if you are in a Euro mood, obviously you can check out either of these. I think Eurotrip is for rent on Amazon. We could not find it streaming anywhere, and Eurovision is obviously on Netflix. Other than that, you can follow us on Twitter at So I'm Watching, Instagram at So I'm Watching the Show. We also have a website, soimwatching.com, which links out to everything. And other than that, just please rate, review, and subscribe wherever you listen. Bye.